We're here in the Mid-Wilshire district of Los Angeles to talk to Richard Berkowitz, the father of safe sex practices. He's got a new documentary out called Sex Positive, so we'll have to hear what Richard has to say. Okay, is it safe to say that you and a few others were the fathers of safe sex practices?
I think the best thing to say is that safe sex came from the scientific theories and background and rigorous science of Dr. Joseph Sonnabend. And Michael Callan and I, who were his patients, became the carriers of the message of his science. And Michael and I each brought something really important to have a message of bringing safe sex to sexually active gay men, which is what was happening when it began in 82, but that it really came from Dr. Sonnabend's science.
And in 82, I mean, everyone's pretty much aware that the Reagan administration was of no help. They had their head in the sand, but I was astonished to learn that even the gay community was fighting you in this effort.
Yeah, I mean, I'm all for demonizing Reagan. I think he did
That's the easy part.
I think he did a lot of damage to the country, and let's not forget that it was the religious right that rose to power on the backs of gay men, fundraising. You know, that gay men were out to what? Fuck their... I don't know who this is for.
Yeah, yeah.
That gay men were out to, you know, basically fuck their children and turn the country communist. You know, using queers, demonizing gay men to fundraise the religious right. And what was the first thing they did? They helped elect Reagan. And who was the first person on the first day Reagan was in the White House? They invited Jerry Falwell, the leader of the whole movement. So, I mean, you could not have eviscerated, you know, gay activism and gay hope better than Reagan did on the first day he moved into the White House than to invite Jerry Falwell, the leader of all the hatred against gay men, into the White House on the first day. So, yes, it was a terrible climate for AIDS to unfold. It's also true that it was extremely difficult for gay men who were, and I was one of them, who were just intoxicated by not just the freedoms of the lesbian and gay liberation movement, that it was okay to be gay, that you were not alone. I mean, this was revolutionary and radical and something to celebrate. And being 17 at the time, not looking too bad either. I mean, I dove in, you know, but it,
you were a looker.
Thank you. It wasn't just that I was, it was that I was happy. It was that,
and y'all.
It was that I went from being ashamed of being gay to being proud of being gay. And it, you kind of exude that kind of confidence and happiness. And I was smart enough to know, you know, I wanted to take advantage of the sexual freedoms, but I wanted to build a sense of family with the gay men who were becoming my friends and brothers. And I think that that really, it's a great to go out and have sexual exploration experiences, but you want to come home at night or at the end of the week and be surrounded by men who are like family to you. I mean, the balance I recognized early was really important. You know, to have friends that were there like family and to really explore the kind of sexual freedoms and opportunities that were just, I mean, it was, no one has captured the incredible gay male sex of the 70s, back before people were waxing their chest and trimming their eyebrows. I mean, people were just having sex as who they were, you know?
It wouldn't.
It was unselfconscious. It was sex in abandon, you know? You didn't.
That was even before the big body craze, right? Everyone was just.
It was, the body craze was just starting. But, you know, when you were young, when you're young and cute, you don't need muscles. You really don't. And when you're a top that knows what he's doing, the muscles don't matter either.
Big demand.
But, I mean, it was such a great time, you know? And it was, you know, I mean, a lot of gay men came from such deep-rooted shame and self-hatred. You know, and I mean, I even went through a period where I wanted to commit suicide over being gay. To suddenly, you know, migrate to these urban centers where gay men were just, you know, being open and brotherly and celebratory and, you know, staking out sections and cities which we claimed as our own. It was just, you know, it's difficult for a new generation to understand just how revolutionary and extraordinary that was. And sex was just, you know, we were men. There were no consequences to sex that couldn't be cured with a pill or an antibiotic. And, you know.
It's also difficult for them to understand how quickly it came crashing down. One minute it was a playground, and the next minute it was a death sentence.
Right. And I think the other part of holding Reagan accountable is holding ourselves accountable, because there was such enormous resistance among gay men to listen to what was happening, to really open up their minds and saying, hey, you know, we're doing a lot of drugs. Why are we doing so many drugs? Why are we running to the STD clinics every other week? You know, are there long-term consequences to what we're doing. It wasn't just AIDS that happened. I mean, there was an outbreak of syphilis. There was an epidemic of hepatitis. There was an epidemic of you know, there were all herpes. I mean, all these STDs were signaling the coming of something really serious. So it wasn't just like, you know, AIDS popped, it was like something fell out of the sky. There were signs that there were health consequences to what we were doing. And it was very demoralizing for the people who went out there in the beginning to try to wake gay men up who just didn't want to hear about it.
People prefer simple answers to complicated questions, even when they're wrong. The city was exploding with sexual playgrounds. The drugs people are doing to have this amount of sex.
Promiscuity was a dangerous activity.
It was what we lived for. I remember thinking, something's changing. Something bad is happening. This was the beginning of the end. This lifestyle, it's killing people.
They were speaking truths that people didn't want to hear.
Very in your face, like we're not even gonna deal with it.
I remember typing how to have sex in an epidemic.
It's the first and really only document advocating safer sex.
People talked about Richard's work as a sex worker.
An S&M hustler who provided pain for a price.
They're throwing theme parties like it's something happening on the other side of the world. Where are their ethics? Where are their brains?
The idea that gay men would wear condoms was ludicrous.
They were hated.
You gotta realize the atmosphere of the time.
We were called the Jerry Falwells of the gay community.
Richard was lost for a few years to God knows what.
People should know who Richard Berkowitz is. He made safe sex sexy.
And I was forever marked as like a self-hating enemy of gay people. I really don't feel comfortable telling you this.
I've just learned that you can be sexually active and remain healthy. I've just learned that you can be a slut, a safe sex slut. I've just learned that there are ways to keep the party going. If you care enough about your partners to protect them, you can still go out there and celebrate and have a great sex life. But you've got to wake up to what's going on. You can't separate caring from the person you're having sex with. And we could keep the party going. But we lost the opportunity for that to happen because older gay men in the community wanted to use AIDS as a bully pulpit to beat gay men over the head and say, settle down, get married, grow up, you know, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, what we lost, so they undermined the effectiveness of safe sex by trying to instill a sense of, well, no one really knows what safe sex is, and we're not sure about this, and we're not sure about that, and they made it very difficult for gay men to feel any confidence with safe sex.